I want to show you some cool techniques you can use to download streamed data using vanilla JavaScript. That means no plugins, nothing from NPM, no node modules, and all using native browser technologies. We are going to hit OpenAI's API, you know, the GPT stuff, and we're going to download data from them, but we're going to do it in a streaming kind of fashion. And so as words come in, we can add it to the page. I want to show you this HTML file just to prove that there's nothing really going on here. There's a bit of third-party CSS, but that's it. We've just got one main.js file to play around with, and that's where all the magic is going to happen. Main.js. Okay, and actually, let me make sure I've got my server running. Okay, there we go. All right, the prompt is going to be tell me a joke, but we need to actually code in that logic. So we've got a URL and we've got an API key, which I'm going to revoke after this video, so don't even try it. And let's make a fetch request. And the fetch request should go to that endpoint. It should pass a messages prompt, an array of messages, which I'll show you in a second. It should specify the model of whatever GPT 3.5 Turbo. And we need to tell OpenAI, hey, stream this data back to us. Don't pass it in its entirety. Once you're done in like however many seconds, just give us word by word if you can. All right. So we've got this fetch request. We're passing in the endpoint and we've got our options here. So yes, it needs to be a post. We've got headers indeed, and that will be content type of application JSON. We've got our API key. Cool. And then we can close that off. And then we've got the body. The body needs to be JSON stringified. So that's all good there. We then need to specify messages, which is an array of objects, I think. Role. Yeah. I think it's like this anyway. But text should be content. I'm pretty sure. Fortunately, if anything doesn't work, we're going to visually see it doesn't work, at least in the Firefox DevTools. Let's make the content something like, you know, tell me a joke. Okay. And then we can do a temperature of whatever, 0.6, just to add some variation because we're going to be reloading the page quite a lot. And model, of course. And that will be GPT 3.5 Turbo. And we can specify a max tokens as well. And those max tokens can be 30 because I don't want to be wasting money every time I reload the page. And we'll close off that body. I'm pretty sure that's enough. We're not specifying any streaming stuff just yet. Go back up to the fetch just so we can assign a variable to it. It equals await. And let's console log await response.json. Cool. Why did the tomato turn red? Because it saw the salad dressing. For a dad joke, it's good. The compelling reason that I want to present to you is reload the page. One, 2 seconds for a tiny, tiny joke with just a few words. So if that's a few seconds, imagine how long it will be for a paragraph of text. We don't want that. We want to do streaming and provide the best user experience that we can by streaming those words to the web page as and when OpenAI make it available to us. We can ask OpenAI to do that by saying within the body, within the payload, stream true. That's it. This is not going to work anymore. And should have kept DevTools open. JSON.parse error, of course. We're trying to call response.json on something that isn't JSON. We're now receiving a stream of data and we need to handle that accordingly. Cool thing number one, you can use for await of. At least in Firefox, for await of does seem to be supported in other browsers. Doing it on a response body seems to only be working in Firefox, right? At least of the time of this recording. Let me show you what the syntax looks like. For await const data of response.body. Response.body is this async iterable. We're just looping over the stream of data on the response.body. And let's log the data. Let's see what it looks like. This kind of looks like something's broken, doesn't it? It looks like that just because it's the raw streams coming in from the network, or the raw chunks rather. This const data, maybe I'll call that a chunk. That's a bit more intuitive to me at least. for each chunk of that streamed body, let's decode it. And to do that, we need to make a text decoder. Decoder equals new text decoder. And decoder.decode chunk. Text decoder is this other web API that is perfect for scenarios like this. We are successfully getting that stream data back. And if I pick a random line, in fact, I can hover over it in VS Code. Let me just pick a random chunk rather, or a random line of a random chunk. So I'm looking for this delta content. Atoms. Okay, so this word atoms is not part of the API schema or specification. It's a word of the joke that GPT is sending back to us. Content because. So it's interesting how OpenAI are sending us this stream data. They're giving us these strings that kind of look like JSON, but is it JSON? Almost. We need to get rid of this data colon space. This is interesting. Just assume that one or more of the lines can have like data colon done to tell us that stream has ended, supposedly. And we need to handle that. Once we handle these edge cases, we can then start parsing the JSON and actually consume the text that we want to display on the page. Okay, let's give this a variable name. Decoded chunk equals. All right, and then with the decoded chunk, each line is almost a JSON object, but first of all, it's each line within the chunk. So decoded chunk dot split, we can split on a new line. All right. And then for each new line, I guess we want to get rid of the data colon. So we can map over that and we can say line equals line dot replace. And we want to get rid of data colon space and replace it with nothing. Let's see what lines looks like right now. Const line lines. And if we log what that is, this is much better. We're making progress. Already I can see there's like some lines that have nothing in it. So we should filter that out. Let's do that before I continue. We only want the lines that actually have a length. Remember the done in square brackets. Well, we haven't handled that case. Here it is. It's a line within the chunk that just says done. We need to handle that example as well. So we can just duplicate that line, filter where the line is not equal to done. Let's check this out. Okay, this is looking good. There's an exclamation mark. That exclamation mark is the ending of the joke. And then this line, there's the word dressing. This is making sense. Now, each line within each chunk is good to go. Finally, we can map. And for each line, JSON.parse that line. Wicked. These are legitimate JSON objects that we can start inspecting and extracting just the text that we need. Because this is like an educational thing, it might be interesting to try destructuring. My gut feeling is that destructuring is going to look weirder than just using like dot and square brackets to access stuff. But let's try it out just as an experiment. We need to loop over every line within the lines for const line of lines. Yep. Let's destructure. Let's get out that content, that word because right here. How do we destructure that? Start out with choices equals line, but then choices is an array, and that array has an object with a property delta like that. And then that has content. And we need to check if content exists. If content, console log content. That is the entire joke or the text from OpenAI being streamed in using vanilla JavaScript, no plugins, and it just works. Before we start appending that text to the page, you know, the page that relies on a document, I want to show you something. Open up the terminal. Stop. All right. Let's run the script that we just wrote with Node.js. That just worked. And that is really nice because we didn't have to change any code. We see that text decoder is working. Async iteration is working. response.body as an async iterable is working. Destructuring is working. We need to append the text to the page. And to do that, instead of just console logging the content, I will document.query selectors. I've got an element on the page and it's got, I think it's got hash content for an ID. In fact, let's just check. Content is the ID. And while we're here, let's enable this button. And I'm going to show you what that's about in a second. Document.query selector hash content dot text content plus equals to content. Boom. I like how simple that was to get working. All the code to me is somewhat intuitive. Maybe some of the data transformation, that's a bit fiddly. If I was doing this in production, I might have used a proper parser, like a parsing library to do all of that rather than using these splits and maps and filters. But all in all, pretty good. Let's add an abort controller. And to do that, we can specify a signal here. And that can reference controller.signal. Controller doesn't exist. Let's const controller equals new abort controller. And we're going to hook up that stop button to tell the controller to actually abort. And to do that, we can document.query selector stop.add. There we go. Controller.abort. Cool. All right. So now the joke. It starts, you know, streaming in, but let's see if we can hit stop. Oh, yeah. And ignore that error. The operation was aborted. That's just because I'm not handling the error. But it works. Abort controller, kind of a relatively new thing. Whoops, I didn't. My reaction times. But there you go. That network request is genuinely being stopped, which is good. That's exactly what we want as web developers, because if you're making a single page app, and your users are going from page to page, you want to legitimately be canceling those network requests to not waste precious bandwidth. But hopefully it's a very compelling reason for you right now. This is a perfect example. Those tokens cost money. The ability to stop that network request when I don't want that network request to continue, this is that ability. It wasn't always in the Fetch API. It's somewhat recent. I'm going to reload, stop. There we go. So the joke has stopped. The joke hasn't finished. And if we find that network request, there we go. You can see it's in red in the Firefox DevTools. And there's an NS binding aborted, which I guess is their internal representation for what happened to that request. Let's do a quick recap of some of the fun stuff that we just covered. We spoke about using the Fetch API, but in a streaming fashion where you can tell OpenAI. Remember, we're not telling Fetch, we're telling OpenAI to stream, right? Just stream that data to us. But the kind of interesting part is how response.body, response being the response of the fetch, is this async iterable, meaning you can say for or wait of, right? And then we're looping over every chunk in that response. And for every chunk, we decode it using a text decoder, which is a built-in API within JavaScript. And that decodes raw network chunks into text. And we can then filter the text, which is all entirely dependent on the API that you're consuming. In this case, it was not too bad. Personally, I would have used a proper parser just so I can be confident that nothing's going to go wrong. Also, don't forget try catches. I've not done any error handling here. Be mindful of that. We saw some funky looking destructuring. Don't know if I'm a big fan of it. I like destructuring in general, but just to get one property content, it might have been easier just to use like dot property accesses and whatever. And finally, we saw the abort controller. It's the ability to stop a network request dead in its tracks. You just pass the signal to the Fetch API. So remember this signal right here, that is not to do with OpenAI. That's to do with the Fetch API. You see it's outside the body. And the very last cool thing that we saw was running this in Node.js. Which, of course, with the document.query selector, it won't work. But with everything else, with the for or wait of, it will work. The abort controller works. The, you know, async iterables of response.body, that works. And in case you're curious, my Node version is 19.7.0. Fairly recent, but it's not the latest. Let's live life on the wild side and just reload the page a few more times just so you can see it. He says, well, carelessly burning away his money. I'm only joking. It doesn't cost too much for these very short jokes. And that's why I specified max tokens 30, just to limit it in case. I hope you enjoyed that. Let me know if there's anything else you want to see related to modern web APIs, maybe this new AI revolution that we're seeing, specifically how you can use it in a web context, including LangChain, if you're interested. Give me a shout. I've been playing around with that recently, and that's been good fun. Thanks for watching. See ya.